Every block in this Minecraft world is a file on my computer. This means that the arrangement of files on my hard drive determines the landscape, and yes, breaking blocks in-game deletes the files from my system. In this video, we'll take a look at how I made this happen, and we'll try to see what it would take to break your computer this way. Before we can get into all the fun stuff like terrain generation, we first have to figure out how to interface with the game. The obvious solution would be to create a mod, but that would require learning a new modding API. Even so, the tools that do exist are geared towards gameplay mods, such as adding items or crafting recipes. We're gonna be going way outside of that box. For a moment, I considered using the code from my last project about the world's smallest Minecraft server. Do check out that video if you're interested. Since I'm intimately familiar with that codebase, it would be fairly trivial to change how the game works. And, by the nature of that project, it would also be relatively lightweight and performant. However, the one major downside of this is the limited feature set that comes with a custom server. What if I want to blow up my files with TNT or spawn a wither? Both of these are things that my bare iron server cannot do. So, the solution I ended up with was to directly modify the level data. After all, that's really all that my program needs to do. Convert the file tree to blocks in-game and read those blocks to see if any have been broken. Now, you'd think that something as popular as Minecraft would have dozens of tools for parsing level data. And for the most part, you'd be technically right. I did find a Python tool that claimed to do just that, but every query just turned up empty. Similarly, there's a JavaScript tool that claims to parse region files, but that one crashes with errors about compression. I did try switching to a version of the game that would have been out when these tools released, but no dice. So, when none of the tools you need are available, the only choice you've got is to give up. And write one yourself. Yeah, it's not the cleanest thing in the world, but it gets the job done. This cobbled together pair of functions can read and write level data just well enough to be viable for what I intend to do. Thus, the next step is to figure out terrain generation. Now, I've already covered procedural generation on this channel before, in that same video about the world's smallest Minecraft server, but this time is a bit different. Instead of generating a noise gradient and converting that to blocks, I'll be using a recursive approach that generates one block at a time. This is a lot less efficient, but since we only have to do this once while generating the terrain, I don't really mind how long it takes. The crucial benefit of this technique is control. I want the shape of the terrain to resemble the layout of files on my computer. In other words, I want nearby blocks to represent nearby files, and distant blocks to represent distant files. Here's how that works. Assume for a moment that we've got a list of all the files on my computer, sorted by their distance to each other. Every now and then, there's a break in the list, separating distinct sections such as major folders. We'll get to how I got this list in just a moment, but for now, that's all you need to know. Our algorithm also has two more lists, one containing open block positions that we plan to consider, and one containing the blocks that we've already placed. These lists start out nearly empty, with the only exception being a starting point in the open list. This is where our algorithm begins. First, we grab the leftmost element of the open list, that's our starting point, and we pair it up with a file from the file list. Then, we generate 6 new neighbors on each side of this block and add them to the open list. Our current node has now entered the closed list and has officially become part of the terrain. That's the end of this iteration. For the next iteration, we once again grab the first element of the open list, this time a neighbor of the first block, and assign it a file. After that, we again generate up to 6 new neighbors, making sure that none of them overlap with the existing elements. Let's fast forward a bit to see how this algorithm takes its shape. You'll quickly start to notice that this looks nothing like Minecraft terrain. By default, this algorithm naturally generates these diamond shapes. That's because, if you think about it, all we're really doing is iteratively mapping out the shortest distance to the next available point. Normally, that would create a sphere, but in this cube-based world, we get the next best thing. To flatten this out a bit, we can simply make vertical neighbors less likely to generate. This definitely helps on the surface, but laterally we've still got the same problem. The way I fixed this was to randomly inhibit generating neighbors in one of 4 cardinal directions. That has the effect of rounding down those sharp corners, which eventually forms a somewhat believable looking island. Let's keep going until we reach the first section break in the file list. This indicates a big jump in the semantic significance to our next file. Because of this, we'll be clearing the open list and starting fresh from just the current node. This has the effect of creating a new island connected to the previous one, yet still visually distinct enough to indicate a new section. Now, full disclosure, this is likely not the best way to generate terrain. Not even close. I chose this method because it lets me incorporate the file structure into the shape of the terrain. Even so, I'm sure there'll be plenty of armchair experts in the comments telling me how to do this properly, but I just don't think it matters for the sake of what I'm doing. Finally, let's get back to how I built that file list. If you think about it, the files on your computer couldn't be further from a linear list. Rather, the data structure they represent is a tree. To extract a list from a tree, you can apply one of many tree search algorithms. If you've ever formally studied computer science, you'll have heard of these ad nauseum. In this case, we'll be using depth-first search, which involves diving as deep into the tree as possible before noting down what you find. By the way, the inverse of this algorithm, which is breadth-first search, was what I described earlier for generating the actual terrain. Anyway, this process naturally puts adjacent nodes next to each other in the list, while nodes from completely different branches end up far apart. And to create that separator, we just have to cut the branches somewhat high up in the tree. Here's what this whole thing looks like in-game. The different colors of wool represent the different groups of files. You'll also notice that some islands are floating off on their own. This is due to a fallback system that kicks in when a new group of files doesn't have space to generate on a previous island. On its own, this is already a pretty cool visualization of my file system, but we're not stopping here. My ultimate goal is to turn this into a playable skyblock world. First, let's paint the surface. We'll replace all the wool with grass, except for the blocks that are covered. Those will become dirt. This makes apparent another issue that makes these islands look uncanny. There are lots of these jagged puzzle piece patterns all across the surface, which are very different from the relatively smooth terrain of vanilla Minecraft. This is where I took inspiration from an old friend. The best solution to a problem is usually the easiest one. So with that in mind, I solved this by simply moving these lonely blocks closer to each other. There's no fancy math here, it really is just as crude as it sounds. Again, this is not the best way to solve this problem, but for a program that only has to run once, it really doesn't matter. Next, it was time to add some foliage. You'll notice that our current algorithm doesn't really support landscape features like trees. All it does is carve out a general shape for each island. You might think that fixing this is just a matter of sprinkling in some trees after the fact, but that doesn't let us assign relevant files to the blocks in that tree. Instead, when generating the terrain, at random points in time, I set aside exactly 62 files from the current list and note down the coordinates of the current node. This is so that after the whole segment has finished generating, I can plant those trees on the surface and map them to semantically relevant files. This already makes a huge difference to the overall vibe of the islands, but we're still not done. What we're missing now are bodies of water on the surface and precious metals underground. For water, I actually just repurposed the same algorithm used for generating the terrain, except instead of growing blocks outward, it's carving blocks inward. This is why you'll often find the same puzzle piece pattern on the edges. But unlike before, we can't just shift these blocks around, as that would require either breaking the barrier and introducing new blocks unaccounted for, or even worse, replacing a water block, thus completely eliminating a file from the mapping. Ultimately, I found that this probably isn't a big enough issue to bother worrying about. Instead, I turned my attention to shaping the area underneath the surface. The first order of business was to add stone, by converting all dirt more than 3 blocks below the surface. For ores, the easy way out would have been to just randomly pepper them throughout this volume, but that's not very Minecrafty. Instead, veins are grown by taking steps in random directions, kind of like a snake, for a random amount of iterations. This is still not exactly how Minecraft does it, but in casual gameplay, the results are practically indistinguishable. Lastly, before we get to blowing up the world and my computer in spectacular fashion, it would be nice to know what file is associated with each block. Now, as a reminder, this isn't a native Minecraft mod, so I can't easily add an on-screen display telling me which block I'm looking at. Or can I? I mean, I have all the level data, so all I'm missing is information about the player. Did you know that by pressing F3 and C, a chat command containing your current position and angles is copied to your clipboard? My program can then automatically read the contents of the clipboard and extract these values. With this, we can model a pretty good approximation of the player's camera in relation to their surrounding blocks. All that's left is to detect which block is in direct line of sight. Checking when a line goes through an object is a very common problem in game development. There are tons of algorithms that do just that. The naive approach would be to check points along this line in regular steps. In most cases, this is good enough. But in certain situations, those points can easily overshoot or undershoot the edge of a block. On the other hand, fancier algorithms that do full ray-to-axis aligned box collision detection will quickly get overwhelmed by the hundreds of thousands of blocks present in the scene. What we're looking for is a cheap iterative algorithm that doesn't miss the edges of blocks. And for that, there's a 3D digital differential analyzer. Yeah, it's not as bad as it sounds. Basically, this is almost the same algorithm that's used for drawing straight lines on your screen. The only difference is that instead of 2D pixels, it assumes a grid of 3D voxels, just like the blocks in Minecraft. For us, this means that looking at a block and pressing F3 plus C will instantly print information about the block and the file it's associated with. Now all that's left is to introduce the destructive element. Simply put, I want the program to detect when a block has been broken and react to that by deleting the file associated with it. So let's start with detection. While it might seem simple enough to just repeatedly scan the game's region files for any changes, it's easy to underestimate the sheer amount of blocks that need to be checked. Each region houses a 32x32 chunk area, which comes out to 1024 individual chunks. Each of those chunks contains 16x16x384 blocks, which multiplies together to just under 100,000 blocks per chunk, leaving a total of 100 million blocks per region file. And by default, there are 4 region files in an empty world. To avoid some very expensive repeat calculations, I first compute a hash of the region file to check if it's even changed since the last time I checked, before computing a hash of the chunk data to see if that has changed, and only then do I actually parse the chunk to see what has changed. This way, if either the chunk or the region hash turns up identical to my previous query, I can be sure that there's no reason to keep going. Now, on to actually deleting the files. If you thought this was going to be as simple as running one command, boy were you wrong. I mean, yes, most files can be deleted this way, even without special permissions, but what about the files that are actively in use by a running program? Windows just outright refuses the operation, and while Linux seems capable of doing it, it'll actually secretly keep that file alive until no programs are using it anymore. So, clearly, to ensure maximum chaos, the only solution is to kill any and all programs that get in the way. This is actually not that hard to do. You can quite often trivially get the IDs of programs holding a given file handle and issue a signal that forces them to shut down. Now, before we get to the juicy gameplay, I want to take a step back and appreciate how this project came to be. The idea of mapping Minecraft blocks to files is not that extraordinary. I'm sure plenty of you have had similar ideas in the past, but the true value is in making that idea come to life. And that is a skill you can learn with the sponsor of this video, Kodi.tech. Kodi offers interactive lessons on many of the relevant programming languages of today, but since my project is written in JavaScript, let me show you what it would be like to learn that. If you're a total beginner, you can start at the very top and learn the very basics of your first programming language. Each lesson explains exactly what you're learning, tells you exactly what you're supposed to do, and gives you the opportunity to learn by doing while you write actual code. If you don't feel like reading, no problem. Lessons have a TLDR button that leaves you with just the most crucial bits. And here's the thing, if you're not a beginner, or if you feel like things are going too slow, Kodi lets you jump ahead to whichever task best matches your pace. To keep you motivated, they've got a streak system, daily personalized challenges tailored to your experience, a weekly leaderboard, achievements, and a bunch more tools to keep you focused on becoming a better programmer. If Kodi sounds right for you, sign up today by using the link in the description. Finally, the time has come to try this out in a real survival mode game. I started this up in a virtual machine running Debian with some basic tools and utilities. From there, I spent some time mining, exploring different islands, fighting mobs, all while periodically checking whether I had broken anything important. After half an hour had passed with no noticeable damage to the system, I decided to speed things up a bit. But even with the ability to summon vast destructive power, there were still way too many islands to take care of by myself. So I went and got some help. I went live on Twitch, got 8 VIP members together in one world, and pretty much just let them go wild. I had a terminal window on screen showing them which files are being deleted, along with the coordinates of the associated blocks. Don't mind the red error messages, by the way, this is just a visual bug. The files are actually being deleted. After about an hour into the stream, we had not only deleted some basic command line tools, but also the default package manager for Debian. And 10 minutes after that, Firefox was gone. So was LibreOffice and the file manager and many other tools. But since the server was still alive, we kept going. Since we were practically in the endgame now, where everything could fall apart at any moment, I decided to give everyone on the server 2 stacks of TNT. And mere minutes after that, the run was over. A critical library had been struck, which was required for the operation of not just my program, but for pretty much every meaningful part of the system. Minecraft was still running, but no other programs could be launched. Even the restart button didn't do anything, and neither did the reboot command. I forcefully shut down and restarted the virtual machine, which, of course, didn't get very far. Yeah, that is not booting. We got grub! Hey, we got a grub recovery shell! I did also do a second round on a fresh VM, this time with creative mode. The problem now was that my program couldn't keep up with the sheer volume of blocks being evaporated by the hordes of ender dragons, withers, ghasts, and artificially juiced up creepers. So while literally all of the land was gone within 15 minutes, the system still remained functional for a while. I did end up fixing the slowdown by processing all the blocks within a chunk asynchronously. This made things a lot laggier for my underpowered virtual machine, but the good news is that on their third round, my viewers needed only 20 minutes in survival to break the system beyond repair. Now, that's all for the Linux side of things, but what about Windows? Testing this was a bit more annoying since I couldn't actually run Minecraft in the virtual machine. Instead, I had to set up a dedicated server that I could connect to from the outside. I started out by just gathering basic resources and exploring different parts of the islands. Eventually, I stumbled upon a coal vein that happened to be linked to some files in System 32. Naturally, this island became my primary mining point. But after cleaning up a good chunk of both the depths and surface of this region, I still couldn't notice a single change in the VM. I mean, I saw some important sounding DLLs being deleted, but everything seemed to work just fine. After about an hour of this, I decided to pivot to digging up my home directory instead. If I couldn't brick the whole system, I wanted to at least crash the server. I eventually managed to hit a crucial stash of links, which broke the taskbar icon for Edge. But I couldn't for the life of me find the Java binary I was using to run the server. I had hit many adjacent Java executables, but was practically dancing around the one that actually mattered. Even though I knew where to look, it was like searching for a needle in a haystack. You know, it might have already been obvious to some, but there aren't actually that many mission-critical files in your system, at least not compared to the total file count. In this regard, I think Linux was easier to break because it's simply less bloated, and even then, half the files we were hitting were LibreOffice help documents. Anyway, after a very unfortunate encounter with a creeper, I decided to call it a day and do a final check-in on the damage. The portable Prism launcher installation was missing a few DLLs, so I guess I did break at least one program, but everything else seemed intact. Even Edge still worked as long as you launched it from the start menu. That said, I knew there was one thing I could do that would definitely kill this machine: rebooting. I had not only dug up a generous portion of System 32, but I also remember striking some files that seemed related to system boot up. There was just no way this thing was coming back up. Until it did, and I don't know how. This genuinely baffles me, and on top of that, the amount of space that this whole process cleaned up was only like 300 megabytes. I don't know what the correct takeaway is from all this, but to me, it just seems like Windows is way too bloated for its own good. A freshly installed system should not be standing after being gutted for 90 minutes straight. I don't know, maybe I just got very lucky. If you want to check out this project for yourself, I'll leave a link to the GitHub repository in the description. By default, this program does not delete your files. The dangerous stuff has to be enabled explicitly. Otherwise, it just acts like a quirky file system visualizer. Even so, I wouldn't recommend using this if you don't know what you're doing. Read the instructions, watch out for warnings, and use a virtual machine if at all possible. Better safe than sorry.